You are now entering the spoiler zone. The following podcast contains explicit plot details and pockets of profanity. You have been warned. The Exton Moss Experiment. Adventures in Wine and Space with Simon Exton and Ken Moss. Hello everyone, and a very warm welcome to another edition of the Exton Moss Experiment. I'm Ken Moss.
I'm Simon Exton.
And this time we are watching Doctor Who, The Face of Evil.
That's the evil one.
I must have made quite an impression.
So Anna,
what's those?
He's worshipped by the tribe. I was cast out for speaking against him.
Destroy!
Zoannon, you'll destroy yourself as well as us!
We must kill the servants of the Evil One.
You are not the Lord of Time, come again to save us.
Now, there is a reason why we've selected this story, isn't there?
Yes, there is a reason we've selected this, and not just because it's a bloody good story. We're watching this in memoriam of Chris Boucher, who has sadly passed away over 6 months ago now. But Mr. Moss has been apparently busy doing stuff.
Bits and pieces.
Trying to appease the tax office, all that sort of shit.
Yes, they do come a knocking.
Yes, Exton Moss recordings have been on a little bit of a hiatus, and unfortunately Mr. Boucher's In Memoriam episode is one of the casualties of that. But we're back now, and we will get it out as quickly as we can. He was the last surviving writer from the 1970s. He has a big role in Doctor Who history because not only did he produce some of the very best of Tom Baker's stories with Robots of Death and Image of the Fendal, but in The Face of Evil, he introduced the character of Leela, who was, to my mind, one of the best, if not the best, 70s companions.
Wow, really?
It's really down to her or Sarah Jane, isn't it?
It's a tough call, but I'd probably go with Sarah Jane. Mind you, I've said that, there are some cracking Fourth Doctor and Leela stories. Tough call.
And Leshaw is brilliant. Romana One is brilliant. But I think in terms of sheer acting powerhouse, Louise Jameson has them all beat. And that's not disparaging to them at all. There wasn't a 70s companion who wasn't a superb actor. It's just Louise Jameson is superlative.
Before we get down to the celebration that is commentating on Doctor Who, we should raise a glass, really. It's time to get out the tonic screwdriver. This time we are drinking Downpour Gin. And the info bollock says, the team at North Ulst Distillery Company use their Hebridean Island location as inspiration for their award-winning Downpour range of gins and their forthcoming whiskey.
Mm-hmm. I think it's pronounced Uist, but...
Oh yeah, there's an I in that. Yep, it is Uist. Oh well, fuck it. The founders grew up in North Uist and wanted to capture the whole...
No, let's not say fuck it. Let's respect the Scots and the way that they would like to pronounce the name of their islands.
Should I do that bit again?
No, we'll keep this bit in. Very definitely. It's all right, I know how little respect you have for the Hebrideans.
Well, we are watching a Doctor Who story about savages. Shall we try again? The team at North Uist Distillery Company used their Hebridean Island... I determined to get through this. The founders grew up in North Uist and wanted to capture the whole essence of the island while still being contemporary and outward-looking. Recently crowned Scottish Gin Distillery of the Year, their continued success has seen the team grow from the two founders in 2019 to a team of 13 today. Downpour Scottish Dry Gin is made using twice the concentration of weight of botanicals compared to the industry average, resulting in a stronger downpour of flavour. These botanicals are separated into those placed in the pot and those placed in the cart ahead of the still, and are weighed out and placed into muslin bags for distillation. A bold, citrus-forward dry gin with lingering spice to finish, the overall honeyed note to the smooth gin comes from their use of wild Hebridean heather. Each batch is named after the place on the island the heather was collected from. To source it, they operate a barter system with locals. Anyone who brings in a bag of heather flowers receives a bottle of gin, made using the very blossoms they foraged. Oh, what a nice thing. So, first things first, Dr. Exton, what is the nasal appraisal?
Oh, it's very heathery.
Struth! Right.
Oh, that's lovely.
That is the strongest smell so far. I don't think it's going too far to say bouquet, is it? Anyway, dive in.
It's pronounced bouquet.
Fucking hell! Wow.
Well, fuck me pink, that's lovely.
That is a tasty gin.
Yes, wow,
is
there any... yummy, yummy, yum. That's absolutely lovely.
I would go so far as to say that is the strongest gin we've ever had in terms of taste.
Oh, no, I don't think so. I'm sure there have been others that... I mean, don't get me wrong, it is a strong gin.
That's like chewing on heather. That is really...
And did she ask you to? Sorry, Heather.
Anyway, that is a very, very potent flavour. Not unpleasant, it was just a surprise. That is so, so tasty.
This is absolutely delicious. I love it. It's very, very, very heather forward to the point where it's a little bit single note.
I will sort of agree, although there is a tang to it. I won't say if...
There's a sort of salty undercurrent to it, which is Scottish coastals, but no, they smacked you around the face with a heather-smeared brick, and it is absolutely delicious.
I am really torn on this because that's one of the best-made gins we've ever had.
You're wanting to give this a 5, but you don't particularly like heathery gins. So.
I know, but it's not so much that. I'm compelled to give it a 5 because it's so well made. It is not entirely for me, but this is brilliant. And even though I'm not 100% fond of it, it is a very, very distinctive, well-made, tasty gin. I'm really blown away by just everything about this one. So even though I wouldn't necessarily race for it, it is 5 worthy, I think. Yourself?
I think this is absolutely delicious, and I think this is very, very definitely worthy of it for 5.
Splendid. So, suitably charged with a glass of something remarkable, it's time to descend into the bowels underneath Podcasting House and open up the Black Archive. Dr. Exton, what have you got this time?
Well, in keeping with our In Memoriams, we recover episodes of things that were written or performed by the person we're memorialising. And the very first writing credit that Mr. Boucher had was in something called Braden's Week. Braden's Week was a magazine show and was fronted by a guy called Bernard Braden. And Braden's Week was a precursor to That's Life. Did feature Esther Anson as one of the investigators, but not as the lead. And they did customer affairs and skits and basically exactly what That's Life came on to do. And he was sacked by the BBC because he had appeared on ITV advertising stork margarine.
Okay, not petty at all.
And they were very clear that was the reason that they got rid of him and said that it was not viable for the host of a consumer programme to be seen to be commercially endorsing goods, which it was the 60s. But the producer, John Lloyd, recognising how good the format was, disappeared off with Esther Anson, who was one of the co-presenters and investigative journalists, and set up That's Life in 73, I think, when Braden's Week started 68 and finished 72.
I didn't realise That's Life was that old.
I went to medical school with Esther Anson's son.
Yes.
As an aside. So, do you have anything?
I do. It's something I hadn't heard of before we did this. It's called The Saturday Crowd. And this is a series from 1960.
Is this something you found for yourself? Well done, you.
This is a series from
1960. Sorry, I didn't catch that.
Maybe somebody else did my research on this. Possibly. This is a series from 1969. It ran for 28 35-minute episodes. It starred Leslie Crowther, who is an LWT series. It was sort of music, chat, and comedy. Now, Leslie Crowther was joined every week by people like Anita Harris, Lonnie Donegan, Sheila Burnett, and Peter Gordano. They were in all the episodes with Leslie Crowther, but there were other people. Oh, the Fifth Peter Dimension.
Gordano as in UFO?
Yes. As himself, it says on IMDb. How are we describing this? The show was well-directed, fast-moving, and peopled with engaging performers, each doing their own thing with grace. But every now and again, the pace slackened, a sketch was allowed to drag on too long, and signs of self-indulgence and private jokery peeped through.
In other words, the Catherine Tate show before its time.
Yeah, sort of. But I believe that 10 episodes are missing. There were 3 written by Chris Boucher, and therefore it's included in the Black Archive.
I have a question.
Fire away.
What's that in the corner?
Oh my. It's spaff leakage.
Leakage. I'm not sure I want any more detail than that.
So here we are back in the viewing room. As with all Doctor Who's, we're going to watch the first and last episodes with full commentary, and we'll give you a little bit of a précis of what happens in the middle bits. Without further ado, it's Ron VT on Doctor Who, The Face of Evil, Episode 1.
Oh, I love this title sequence.
I know
I say that every time.
That. The Doctor meets the Tribe of the 17. 17? First shown on New Year's Day, 1977. Which means that there must have been a gap. Because otherwise...
What, for Christmas, yes.
Deadly Assassin 4 should have been on Christmas Day then.
But there was only one classic episode of Doctor Who shown on Christmas Day.
There was, but now I realise that there could have been more.
There could have been, but there weren't. And let's be honest, at this point, it was Doctor Who was not exactly full-blown prime time. And realistically, can you imagine this being shown on Christmas Day?
Not this one, no, which it would have been, wouldn't it, rather than Deadly Assassin.
On the other hand, had they given the production team enough budget to do a Christmas special in between Deadly Assassin and Face of Evil, how good would that have been?
Do you know, I think Tom Baker would have met a good Doctor at Christmas.
And who would you have put in as stunt companion in the way that they've done with the modern ones?
Well, we're too early for Amelia Rumford. It would have to be Mrs. Tyler, wouldn't it? Oh, no, it couldn't be her either.
Do you know who I'd put in?
Go on.
Well, bear in mind it's Christmas and lighthearted and science fiction around this sort of time in the 1970s.
I know where you're
Mrs.
going
Mrs. Noah. Oh, how much fun would that be? Molly Sugden and Tom Baker bouncing off each other in comedy sci-fi. It would have been joyous.
Well, actually, I was thinking more along the lines of, consider me available for future assignments. Because she'd have been in it by this point.
Amelia Dukar.
The name's Dukar, actually. But I find it interesting that both of us veered towards older companions rather than anyone else.
Oh, I mean, Rumford and Tyler investigates and...
the Big Finish series that never was.
Yeah, don't be giving them ideas. And, yeah, that would have been fantastic. And I love the idea of an older companion. Okay, it would have to be fairly short-lived because you couldn't do any action-y things that you'd need. This is a really good jungle set.
Mm.
How often does he talk directly to camera? Not terribly often.
The only other instance I can think of is the end of Invasion of Time, when he pulls out K9 Mark II and grins directly to camera.
And Feast of Stephen, as we mentioned earlier.
Yes, of course.
I don't like it, to be honest.
No, it breaks that fourth wall.
And if you're going to break the fourth wall, fair enough. Break the fourth wall, shatter it into pieces, do a moonlighting.
Oh, now you see, I never saw the last episode of Moonlighting. I know it's there, but I was way too young for it when it was on.
Louise Jameson sells the whole... She doesn't really sell savagery that well, because she's a bit...
Beautiful.
intellectual, I was going to say. But the physicality of it, yeah, she absolutely sells. The others, less so.
See, much as I love Leela as a character, I think it would have been better played by somebody black, almost sort of Amazonian warrior queen sort of thing. I mean, she's very beautiful and it's distracting. It takes you out of the whole savage thing because she's so pretty. And
saying that a black actress wouldn't be similarly pretty.
Yeah, but black actresses playing sort of Amazonian women, they've got there's more gravitas to it. Look at somebody like Grace Jones. That level of striking but beautiful at the same time. But look at Grace Jones. You wouldn't fucking argue with that, would you?
I wouldn't argue with Louise Jameson, frankly.
True. I'm talking about in character rather than the...
I very definitely wouldn't argue with Leela. His costume is scant. Not quite as scant as the wet blokies in the river in loincloths in full circle flashing their arses, but, you know, John and Nathan Turner.
I was going to say, was that not dropped in for the male contingent of the audience who might appreciate that sort of thing?
I suspect it was dropped in for the producer.
I'm not overly keen on the very obvious ribbed pipes as part of the jungle set. They do stand
out. No, I think the jungle set works really well. It makes it look very alien. I mean, it's a bit Space 1999, but that was the 70s aesthetic.
Don't get me wrong, it's nicely dressed and nicely lit and filmed. It's done on film, which always makes a difference. Manu, I say it's nicely lit. There's some horrible shadows.
You can see how she made him up her game, because Liz Sladen was a superb actress, and you see her in Doctor Who, you see her in other stuff. She's superb, but she's possibly a bit too nice to really force him into raising his acting game. Whereas Louise Jameson, listening to interviews with her, and I've met her, and she's an absolutely lovely person.
Mm.
But she's very passionate about the craft of acting.
Oh, you need to look at all the work she's done with Nigel Fairs. Those two are clearly kindred spirits through the Big Finish and what have you. And they want to produce and write good material. Now, I've got to be honest, I've never heard any of the rest of this stuff. Have you done any of the Omega Factor stuff?
I've heard all of it. It's wonderful. It's not as good as the original Omega Factor TV series, but that's one of my very favourite TV series. Omega Factor, Survivors, Tomorrow People, particularly the ones that Louise Jameson has written herself, are incredibly good. And there's a thing in Survivors series where they split the characters into two groups, and you've got a group of all the female characters and you've got a group of all the male characters, and the female characters go off and do all the actiony stuff and the male characters go off and are a bit less actiony, and it works brilliantly. And Louise Jameson wrote one of those, and it is one of the best things that Big Finish has ever put out. Now, I have my problems with the way the Survivors series just got more and more and more and more dramatic, in the way that the Russell T. Davis Doctor Who's just got more and more and more dramatic. And towards the end, it was sort of threats to the universe and multiverse and all of that. But I have for years said that the mark of quality in anything from Big Finish is if it's got Louise Jameson's name on it, either as actor or writer. And I saw her in one of my very favourite plays in London, and she was incredible. She was playing Mrs. Boyle in The Mousetrap, and she was fantastic.
Now, I'm sorry to cut across you there, but why have we switched to videotape here at the same set?
I don't know.
I will say this about quality-wise, or visual quality-wise, a lot of the 70s and early 80s stuff was done on 2-inch videotape. And the further you get into the 80s, certainly when you get to McCoy's era, it's all done on 1-inch videotape. And there's a noticeable drop in quality, so that a lot of the McCoy stuff now looks worse than stuff shot in the 70s.
I mean, after the Troughton era, which I never saw first time around, but I just absolutely love, this era of Doctor Who is my happy place because it's what I grew up with.
You see, I didn't grow up with this. I came to all of these when they were on UK Gold Omnibus editions in the early 90s. So I completely fell in love with this middle Tom Baker bit.
I don't remember watching this first time around.
Because what would you have been, about 9 when this was on?
This was 70s. It was
11 days off being 9. Is that just religious
gobbledygook, or is that an actual place? Was it 77 or 78?
Oh, no, you wouldn't. You've been 11 days off being 8. Yes.
Yeah. I mean, New Year's Day, there isn't a cat in hell's chance I would have watched this.
Really?
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. There's an... that's quite a dramatic pose that he's sitting in.
Old lady on a park bench.
No, it's... I am man, behold my cock. No, I used to watch Doctor Who at this sort of time at my grandparents' place because my parents were at work on a Saturday. So my sister and I would be looked after by my grandparents. And how much of Doctor Who I got to watch depended on what time my parents got back from working. And if I was lucky, I'd get to see the whole episode. But the second they turned up, the telly went off. And if they turned up before the episode was on, then I didn't get to watch it.
Now, I was about to compliment the makeup on all the faces, and certainly the fronts of the bodies are all nicely tanned, as they would be in this sort of environment. It's clearly quite warm. But he turned round, and his back is almost translucent. So makeup have only bothered with the front.
Maybe he spent all of his time on his back?
Oh, this was in the stages when Louise Jameson still had brown contact lenses.
Yes, pre-horror Fang Rock.
Yeah. In fact, there's a horrible scene in Robots of Death where one of them slips. Oh. Oh. Anything to do with eyes goes right through me. Would you mind if I turned round? I feel a bit silly talking to this tree. I know we've got different stances on squeamishness. It'd be a little bit odd if a doctor was squeamish.
Oh, there is something I'm squeamish about. It's not eyes. I can poke about with eyes, no problem at all. But nobody has absolutely nothing that you don't get worked up about.
What's yours then, out of interest?
Oh, bone marrow sampling. I hate listening to it. I can do it. I can watch it. That's not a problem. It's just this horrible crunching noise as you work your way through the pelvic bone. It is horrible. It is a million times worse than nails down a blackboard.
Just nipping backwards to where we were talking about him talking to himself, Tom Baker wanted to go it alone for quite a while, I believe, when Sarah Jane left. And you can see from the opening scene of this how dreadful that would have been.
That would have been terrible. Now, companion of the story, absolutely perfect. So Leela for this one, and then what next? Toos.
And then Henry Gordon Jago. He would have been a fine contender. Who have we got after?
Well, it's Skinsale, probably. Or Harker. And at some point, he would have had the loony old trout as a companion. So I can see that working well if it hadn't been for Tom Baker's ego taking over, which it would have done.
I know it's out of its time, but can you imagine, it's just popped up on the info text about merchandising. They had half an eye on merchandising with Leela's bracelet. Can you imagine now how they would milk Doctor Who in the Tom Baker era, given that by this point he was really getting into his stride and it was a big thing in the ratings?
Well, at the time, you had the Leela figure, didn't you? Which was a treat.
I can't say that I've seen it.
Oh, Google it. It's fairly horrific. There's Lady Cassandra, the destroyed
possibly
version.
The worst piece of Doctor Who merchandise there's ever been.
I mean, having said that, that was because apparently Woolworths or whoever it was that would Woolworths still have been going then?
Yes, yeah, it was.
B&M or whoever insisted on an exclusive piece of merchandise, and that is what the BBC told them they could have.
I wonder how many of those were sold in bargain buckets for 20p. Destroyed Cassandra. It can't have been an exclusive. I remember seeing that in Asda.
Apparently that was the reason behind it. How true that is, I don't know. I heard it on some podcast or other. Well, that's an outfit.
It certainly is.
Now, how camp was that?
It's beautifully lit in certain scenes and then not beautifully lit in others. And I've got to give them the dues. There's a very good feel to this story. The casting's good and just the general feel of it is bloody hell. Now, you don't see that so often.
Jane is the one who paralyzes. Janice Thorne sounded too much like the out of work actress. Well, they're not wrong. I mean, it's all a bit male fleshy in a way that Doctor Who rarely was.
Was this, I hesitate to say, before the era where Doctor Who became a little bit gay? Because I suspect it's always been a bit of a gay production, behind the scenes.
I think the word you're looking for is camp rather than gay.
Yeah, yes, that would be better. But I think by the time we get to John Nathan Turner, he was actively appealing to the gay audience, whereas I don't think it was at this point.
Well, with John Nathan Turner, he was the gay audience.
But it has to be said, and well, I've never really...
That's a gratuitous arse shot, frankly, isn't it?
But now we're back to being on film again. It varies wildly.
And there is an awful lot of bloke arse on display.
Mind you, Leela's terribly easy on the eye. For some of us rather than others, but I imagine that was quite a draw on Saturday nights.
This looks fantastic.
It does. But again, film. If only all Doctor Who had been done on film. And then we're on to video for the effect shot. Who was directing this thing?
I don't know. I never know about production details like that.
Leslie Schofield, Johnny Briggs' dad. Wasn't really your time, Johnny Briggs.
No.
You would have been, 15, 16 by the time that was on.
15, I'd have been a bit busy with O-levels.
Come on, who directed it? Come on. Pennant Roberts.
Behave.
Well, these little technical aspects bug the arse off me. I've not seen this for years. I've not seen this since the VHS days, I don't think. But that really stood out. Why the hell were you flitting between film and video?
It's weird. It's a really good story that I very rarely watch.
Well, we're off to watch episodes 2 and 3. We'll be back with a bit of a pricey after we've done that. Well, in those middle two episodes, the Doctor can't recall why his face is on the planet. So, inevitably, after a series of trials and tribulations, they scale the cliff face and go through the Doctor's mouth into a cave, where they meet the Tesh, the technologically advanced sort of alter ego tribe to the Sever-Team. The Doctor works out that they're both different factions of the same lost expedition, and that the voice that's being heard is Zoannan, a highly sophisticated computer. At some point in the past, the Doctor has repaired Zoannan, but forgot to wipe his personality print from the data core, and is left the computer with a split personality. The Doctor starts remembering his earlier adventure, and goes to have a chat with Zoannan in the spaceship that they found beyond the mouth of the cave. But at the end of episode 3, which is a cracking cliffhanger, Zoannan, who is on screens around the wall with the face of the Doctor, just starts screaming, "Who am I?" in different voices, including a child's voice, and it's really creepy.
The computer hadn't failed at all. It had evolved into a living creature, the first of an entirely new species. When it woke, it had a complete personality. Mine. And that's when it started to go mad.
And where is it?
This poor man.
Man, machine, creature.
It's here, Zoannan, and I'm talking to it. It's you! Zoannan.
I grow tired. I'm thinking no longer.
No, wait, Zoannan. I'm the Doctor. I'm separate. I'm real.
Really both enjoyed that. It's time for part 4. What do you think, Dr. Eggston?
Time for episode 4. You count us in.
In 3, 2, 1, run VT.
I have to say, the DVD menus are beautiful because it's all sort of tracking shots of the secondary control room. which I'm a big, big fan of.
I really loved the episode cliffhanger to episode 3. Because I think it's got a real chill factor. The very first time I ever saw it was on VHS when I bought it. And it's just got a real blah.
And this bit in the room with the screens has a bit of a Sharda feel to it, doesn't it?
Oh, yeah. And in the reprise, it's not in. When Zoanna's screaming, who am I?
No, I was more thinking in that holding cell where, let me tell you about my wonderful new master.
Yeah, yeah.
The Tesh, they're
dumb folks.
I did quite like the way she just kicked him.
If you've been impatient to see Peter Baldock as generic Tesh acolyte number one, here he is.
That's nice, but I don't know who he is.
I think they've been having a whale of a time just writing the info text sometimes.
And that's a very nice scene, let down a little bit by CSO.
Yeah.
Most powerful computer ever built.
Why was he trying to hurt you?
He's insane.
See, at this period of Tom Baker's performance, we're going through the alternating between light and very, very dark. And I do quite like that, because we lost it in the, I won't say middle years, but towards the Graham Williams era, when he had basically free rein as to how to act the part.
Yeah.
Now, don't get me wrong, there's some great moments in the Graham Williams era. But for me, the best Fourth Doctor is when he's that real, serious, edgy. I still like Seeds of Doom. I mean, someone's put him in a right mood for that one, but I think it really works.
I love Seeds of Doom. Yeah, you see, that bit doesn't really ring true, where you've got somebody who has been trained to do the whole intellectual stuff, managing with one elbow thrust to disable somebody who's spent her entire life learning how to fight. You see, that would have been so much better if she was the one to have done the fighting. But 1970s, and she's got Uggs before their time.
He's got a touch of the, what's it, out of Lord of the Rings. What's his name?
Oh, I don't know. You like that shit, I don't.
Strider for the boys and girls at home. Can't remember his damn name, not Viggo Mortensen.
You mean Aragorn?
Yeah.
I know he's supposed to be playing brainwashed, but actually it just looked like he doesn't know how to act.
And the very stupid have one thing in common. They don't alter their views to fit the facts.
That's a great quote.
Which can be uncomfortable. If you happen to be one of the facts that needs altering.
Do you know, I've never really given this story enough credit. Because there's some nice sets in this in terms of changing locations. It's not, I've always pictured it always being jungle sets and things, but there's a lot going on. And it's not overlit. It's nicely moodily lit.
It's marvellous. It's a good story. The problem is it sits in the middle of a whole load of phenomenally good stories.
Mm. Yeah, that
so
is true.
So you think about what else you've got in this season. You start off with Mask of Mandragora. You've got Robots of Death. You've got Talents of Wang Chiang.
Hand of Fear, Deadly Assassin. They are all brilliant.
Hand of Fear.
Hand of Fear I love. That's Sarah Jane and the Doctor at the top of the game.
Yes, it's saved by Sarah Jane's exit sequence and female Eldrad.
Do you think I really like The Hand of Fear?
But actually, having watched this last week in preparation for this, I really like Face of Evil, and I'd never really thought that much of it. But that's because of, one, not having seen it first time around, and two, just how good the stuff coming around. And no matter how much fun it is, are you going to watch this or are you going to watch Robots of Death?
Yeah, it's no comparison, really, is it?
Are you going to watch Hand of Fear or are you going to watch Mask of Mandragora? I'll have to be quicker than that, you overblown adding machine. I mean, it's really not my thing, but in stories like this, I can see just how well cast for the whole appeal to the dads thing Louise Jameson was. in the same way as I can see it with Annika Wills and Mary Tam. And
I'm just thinking through the stories here, because it, for all that it's easy on the eye, practicality-wise, for where they go, she gets out of that costume quite a bit, doesn't she? I'm just trying to think of how many times we actually see her in it after this. She's in Robots of Death.
Horror Fang Rock and Talent of Wang Chang, she wears period-appropriate clothing. Image of the Fendal, she has the whole different, I like the new dress, this is the old dress thing. All the rest of the time, she's in the leather bikini thing. What else does she change out of it for? She's got a much bigger loincloth flap covering her ass than any of the blokes have. Hasn't she? You may not have noticed, but...
I haven't, no. But I'm looking at it from quite a different angle. It was a brilliantly designed costume, though, because for all that there's a lot of flesh on show, and it's tantalising as to what's underneath, you never, ever get a wardrobe malfunction.
Yeah, whereas look at the blokes' costumes by comparison, and there's, how shall I put it, buttock reveal.
Yes, but nobody's going to be looking at the men. Who would do that? Exactly, but you didn't exist in 1977. You were a new thing.
Well, I was alive in 1977. I had already seen Craig Stirling. The seed was sown.
And the Tomorrow People.
Fuck me, Pink. What bit of the Tomorrow People do you think was...
Having now seen enough of the original Tomorrow People, I now realise that it was basically the writer's desire to get male flesh on screen and young male flesh.
Very young male flesh, never been my sort of thing.
Well,
I refer
but you
back.
You were very young when that was on.
Yes, it doesn't matter. I refer you back to Craig Stirling. Very, very definitely adult. No, there wasn't a single one of the Tomorrow People. Even John, who did actually look like an adult, was a bit clean-cut and straight-laced. And I appreciate how clean-cut and straight-laced Stuart Damon is, but, you know.
Yeah, about the other end of the scale, there's nobody more clean-cut, is there?
Well, Johnny Dillon is fairly clean-cut. Dear Johnny.
Dead Johnny.
Right, there you go. See how much male arse is on display?
Oh, I see what you mean. Yeah, there is a bit, isn't there?
I mean, if Louise Jameson was in a costume like that, can you imagine
the ratings.
Mary Whitehouse's apoplexy?
Spitting Image once did a skit of Mary Whitehouse. If all this violence and sex on television's so bad, how come you're not affected, Mary? And she's just there machine-gunning the cat.
This is really good in a Joe Grant kind of way, where Leela starts off amenable to brain control in exactly the same way that Joe does. And then she's got to know her own mind and her own brain well enough to be able to say, fuck you to the people who are trying to control her. Oh, my God, he's running along like a camp thing. He wasn't great. Whoever he wasn't great.
It took 5 8-hour sessions to edit this. That's some bloody fast going.
Yeah, you see, look at that costume that Pretty Bloke is wearing. Can you imagine the complaints if Leela had been wearing anything quite that revealing?
Well, there wouldn't have been complaints from the men.
How long have I been out?
2 days.
2 days? I haven't got time to be lying around here for 2 days.
What happened?
Don't you listen?
She is marvellous with things like that. And...
I've told them all I can, but they won't listen to me. They say I'm ignorant. We have a guard.
Well, we've gone into standard Exton Moss mode and we're not commentating because we're so gripped by what's going on.
Yeah, and... It's weird that there. It's not particularly weird. It's unusual. There's this length of a post-climax resolution of the story because they've done the whole dramatic thing, and now it's all finishing the scene setting. it's important to the plot, but the drama finished with the big Doctor Unconscious thing. Mind you, this was about the first drama that Chris Boucher did, wasn't it? There was the occasional episode of, something like Zed Cars or something.
But he really got hold of this and made it his own. I mean, he did two stories back to back, and that hadn't been done for a long while. I think the only other person that did that, well, if you don't count Terror and Sticks, was Ian Stuart Black, I think, and that was a good 10 years before.
We always count Terror and Sticks.
Hmm. But Chris Boucher also, he ran with this when the BBC Books, they got the license to produce Doctor Who novels. Because he basically did his own season of Fourth Doctor and Leela novels. And they were really good.
They were mostly really good. And then you get Match of the Day.
I'm going to say that's the only one I didn't read.
Yeah, it's not great.
What was it about, roughly?
I can't remember. It was a kind of Running Man thing from what I recall, but it really wasn't good. Whereas some of the others were brilliant.
Do you know, I've forgotten that. A cigarette case with jelly babies in it. And I always thought that it was a Peter Capaldi flourish. It's been done before.
And this is a bit like the end of The Savages. How small is his loincloth?
You're looking a lot further down the screen than I am.
Well, you look and imagine what the response would be if Leela's loincloth was that small. Don't get me wrong, I'm not complaining. I'm merely pointing out.
My people would never accept the leadership of a mindless savage.
A last insult!
I am a mindless savage, Jabel, and I have talked with Zoanna.
And that makes Leela the obvious candidate.
And she should go, oh, fuck no.
And here we are, back on video. Why?
Because, preempted by the Gerry Anderson TV movie Into Infinity. Have you seen that?
No.
Oh, we'll do it at some point. It's fucking awful.
Oh, now you see, there was a gap between Deadly Assassin and this. So this was promoted as the start of a new series of Doctor Who.
Yeah, because the whole Christmas thing.
Well, that was rather fun.
That was marvellous. And it may well have been Chris Boucher's first story, but it was, or it was certainly his first full story, first science fiction, first story for Doctor Who. It was brilliant. I really, really enjoyed that. And I tend to forget about Face of Evil because it sort of gets swallowed up in the whole of the brilliance of that season. And there are brilliant stories in that season.
I think you've pegged it down really quite hard there as to why it does generally get overlooked. Because I'd never thought about it before. We're deep in the heart of Hinchcliffe territory here, which for many people is the golden age of Doctor Who, and understandably so. So some have got to be less well regarded than others. This generally does get overlooked, but it's only because, as you say, it's surrounded by gems.
Yeah, and it's really, really good. I really enjoyed that. So well done, Mr. Boucher.
Yes, thank you for everything. And boys and girls, we can heartily recommend a very overlooked Doctor Who story. Go out there and find it. Until next time, thank you very much all of you for listening. It's been our pleasure to watch. We hope it's been your pleasure to listen. We'll be back soon.
Bye now.
The Exton Moss Experiment featured Simon Exton and Ken Moss. All featured soundtracks are the property of their respective producers, and no infringement of copyright is intended. Title music was performed by the BBC Symphony Orchestra, and the programme was produced by Maverick Productions. For more information, please visit maverickproductionsuk.blogspot.com or find us on social media.